इम्तियाजुर रहमान, सीईओ एंड होल टाइम डायरेक्टर, मिस्टर सुरोजित साह, चीफ फाइनेंशियल ऑफिसर, मिस्टर विनय लखोटिया, हेड ऑपरेशंस, एंड मिस्टर संदीप सामसी, हेड इन्वेस्टर रिलेशंस एंड कॉर्पोरेट कम्युनिकेशंस। एज अ रिमाइंडर, ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट लाइंस विल बी इन द लिसन ओनली मोड एंड देयर विल बी एन ऑपर्चुनिटी फॉर यू टू आस्क क्वेश्चंस आफ्टर द प्रेजेंटेशन कंक्लूड्स। शुड यू नीड असिस्टेंस ड्यूरिंग द कॉन्फ्रेंस कॉल, प्लीज सिग्नल एन ऑपरेटर by pressing *10 on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Imtiazur Rahman. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you very much for the wonderful introduction, and good afternoon to all of you. It is my great honor to welcome all of you on my personal behalf, behalf of my three distinguished colleagues, Mr. Surjit Saha, Mr. Vinay Lakhotia, and Sandeep Samsi, and the entire organization, to this call to discuss the financial and operating performance of our company for the first quarter of the financial year 21-22. You may have gone through the press release and investor presentation. They are available on our website and the website of the exchanges. I trust you and your families are safe. The financial year 21-22 began in the midst of severe COVID-19 wave 2. However, it is to the nation's credit that we were able to recover from the second wave. On Indian economy, this quarter continued with the positive sentiment in industrial and commercial activities, barring the month of April, which was impacted due to various restrictions. RBI has projected a growth of 9.5% of GDP for financial year 21-22, as against the contraction of 7.3% in financial year 2021. With an 18% increase in the export this quarter, RBI revised the GDP growth projection to 18.5% in this April-June quarter. The growth in the second quarter has also been revised to 7.9%. We believe that the economy is expected to perform better in the second half of the year, with the fundamentals bouncing back. Let me share with you, friends, on Indian capital market. The benchmark indices, Sensex and Nifty, rose 6% and 7% respectively during this quarter. The stock market rose to register two monthly gains after closing lower in April, boosted by a number of factors like decline in number of COVID-19 cases, easing of pandemic-related restrictions, and better-than-expected earnings reported by companies in the previous quarter. I am pleased to share with you about the growth in the Indian mutual fund industry. The quarterly average AUM of Indian mutual fund industry for the quarter ended 30th June 2021 was Rs. 33,17,541 crores. The quarterly average AUM year on year basis grew by 34.7%, and the average AUM for the quarter ended June 21. The closing AUM as on June 30, 2021 was Rs. 33,66,876 crores, as against Rs. 25,48,848 crores as on 30th June 2021, a year-on-year increase of 32%. During the quarter, all categories saw an increase in the AUM except for the income fund. The mutual fund industry added 12 lakh investor portfolios during this quarter, as against the 20 lakh added in the entire year of 2021. The number of mutual fund investors has increased to 2.39 crore as on June 31, 2021, indicating the robust growth of the industry. The number of folios rose by 4.84% in the April-June quarter. The number of outstanding folios as on June 30, June 2021 is at 10.26 crore. The buoyant equity market has proved to be lucrative for the retail investors, and the major investments came in pro SIPs. The SIP contributions went up to ₹9,156 crores in June 2021, registering a growth of 15.65% from June 2020. The SIP inflows for the quarter stood at ₹26,571 crores, an increase of 8.82% over the first quarter of the previous year. The rise in SIP accounts crossed the 4 crore mark, serving as a testament to the fact that retail investors have developed more confidence in the mutual fund industry. Friends, I am now pleased to share with you about the AUM and other details of UTI Mutual Fund. UTI AMC Group AUM stood at ₹12 lakh crore as of June 30, 2021, as against 9.83 lakh crore as of June 2020, and ₹11.61 lakh crore as of March 2021, registering a growth of 22% during the 12-month period. Our quarterly average AUM for the first quarter of financial year 21-22 was ₹1,87,210 crores against ₹1,82,853 crores as on 31st March 2021 and ₹1,33,631 crores from June 2020. The quarterly average AUM grew by 40.1% from June 2020. UTI MF quarterly average AUM market share stood at 5.64%. The closing AUM as of 30th June 2021 stood at ₹1,93,940 crore, and increase of 9.7% approximately, as against 1,76,796 crore as of 31st March 2021. The closing AUM has shown a year-on-year growth of 35.1% from June 2020. UTI MF market share, closing market share, stood at 5.76%. as on 30th June 2021. During this quarter, UTI MF was able to capture 10.24% of the overall industry net inflow as compared to 6% during the previous year. Keeping in line with the industry trend, all categories of funds except income funds saw inflows during the quarter under discussion. Our ETF and index funds net inflow constitute around 11.58% of the industry net inflow during the quarter under consideration, while the equity fund net inflow for the period stood at 6.24% of the industry net inflow. In this period, UTI has added 1.03 lakh folios as compared to 1.13 lakh folio the company was able to add during the entire previous financial year. As of 30th June 2021, the live folio stood at 1.11 crore for UTI Mutual Fund. The SIP account rose by 31% since June 2020, with over 15.82 lakh live SIP folios in June 2021. The SIP inflows for June 2021 was rupees 348.43 crores, a growth of 45% from June 2020 number. The SIP inflows for the quarter stood at rupees 1,009 crores, rising by 40% from the corresponding quarter in financial year 2021. The SIP AUM increased by 55% from rupees 9,985 crore in June 2020 to rupees 15,523 crore in June 2021. We believe that our investors has and will continue to have a lot of confidence in us. Let me share with you some other details. As you may be aware now, UTI AMC has elevated Mr. Vetri Subramaniam as the Chief Investment Officer of the company and Mr. Ajay Tiagi as the Head of Equity. Both these elevations will be implemented and effective from August 1, 2021. Please join me in wishing them all the best. I am pleased to inform you that we have appointed Mr. Krishutan Dastu as Group President and Head of Sales. Mr. Dastu joins us with over 27 years of valuable experience in the financial service sector. His expertise and experience will help our company further develop our distribution network. We have also onboarded Mr. Sudhanshu Asthana as a fund manager. He brings in an experience of over 21 years in the financial market and over 16 years of experience in the fund management industry. His addition could bring in increased efficiency in our fund management capabilities. We are in the process of making our fixed income investment team more stronger. We are planning to have a comprehensive training and development program for our colleagues. On governance, let me share with you, our risk management committee of the board will meet at least 4 times in a financial year. We are in the process of forming an ESG committee of the board. We have appointed KPMG as the statutory auditor of UTI AMC. We have also appointed E&Y as the statutory auditor of UTI mutual fund scheme. We have appointed an advisor to help us with our ESG initiatives. It is our consistent endeavor to enhance focus on our distribution partner and drive efficiency. We have reorganized the business development function of our sales team by creating 2 different units. We are focusing on the top 30 cities and revisiting our strategy in the beyond 30 cities to deepen further our presence. We are focusing on digital strategies and refreshing our digital assets like website and app. We have launched WhatsApp for distributors and launched live chat facility on website, WhatsApp and chat box. On COVID care, UTI initiated a vaccination drive for our employees and their families. We have also launched financial assistance program for supporting the children of those employees who have lost their lives during COVID. I am at pain to share with you, during this COVID-19 wave 2, we lost 3 of our distinguished colleagues. May their respective soul rest in peace, and God must give enough strength to the family to fight this loss. I am confident these initiatives will surely enhance our abilities to grow substantially and stronger. UTI AMC financials, as you may have seen from the presentation, UTI AMC financial improved on the back of strong net flows and cost optimization measures taken by us. The company recorded consolidated net profit of rupees 155 crore, a rise of 53% year on year, contributed by 53% rise in operating revenue. The operating profit margin as a percentage of AUM for the April-June quarter was 16 bps as against 12 bps for the financial year 2021. Along with the improvement in our operating profit margin, ROE of the company on a consolidated basis is 19.9% in quarter one of financial year 21-22. The PAT margin stands at 44% during the same period. Net worth of the company on consolidated basis is rupees 3,400 crore as on June 2021. With this, we open the floor for addressing any questions, any queries that you have. And as I mentioned to you, I'm joined by my colleagues, Mr. Surajit Saha, CEO of the company, Mr. Vinay Lakhotia, Head of Operations, Mr. Sandeep Santi, Head of Corporate Communication, Strategy and Investor Services, Investor Relations, to address any questions that may come up. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. The first question is from the line of Viraj from Securities Investment Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. And I hope everyone at UTI...
Viraj, sorry to interrupt you. Can I request you to speak a little louder?
Yeah, is it audible now?
Thank you.
Yeah, hi. So thanks for the opportunity. And I hope everyone at UTI is safe and healthy. I just have three broader questions. First is on the employee cost. You know, in the past calls as well, we talked about us looking to, you know, rationalize the cost and expecting somewhere around 65 to 70 crores of savings over the next 2 to 3 years. So is it that, you know, the bulk of the savings we would expect it to be more back-ended, say, in FY 23 or 24, and we may not see much of a gain in 22. The reason I'm asking this is because, you know, if I look at last year, we added somewhere, you know, net employees count has increased by 100 employees. And even in this quarter, there's been an increase of, you know, employees by around 4 crores. So just trying to understand, you know, how should we expect this to play out for us? And a related question here is, you know, since we approved this 2007 ESOP plan, you know, at the AGM, is there any revision to the ESOP charges, you know, which we have been communicating earlier? So that's one.
Okay. Vinay and Surajit, can you take the implied cost saving and the increase in cost? Vinay, you take about saving of implied cost, and Surajit, you take what is the why it has increased, then I will take the ESOP related questions.
Yeah, if you go by the figure of Q1 FY21 and Q1 FY22, if you see the employee benefit expenses in Q1 FY21, it was 98 crores. And now this quarter, it is 94 crores. So actually, the cost has decreased from 98 to 94 crores because of the ESOP expenses, which, you know, earlier we have said that last year, FY2021, it was 30 crore, and this year the ESOP cost for the already ESOP which has been allotted, it is 12 crores. So accordingly, we have seen a reduction in employee costs. But if you go by the quarter, that is Q4 FY21 and Q1 FY22, the cost for Q4 is 74 crores against 94 crores. That is mainly because of the, if you remember, in the last quarter in Q4, we have We have reduced the variable pay expenses. That is, if you remember, till December, we booked a variable pay expenses of 45 crore. And actually, according to the KRA in the March figure, what we booked in the books of accounts is 38 crore. In the last quarter, we have reversed 7 crore. And this particular quarter, we have utilized for variable pay 9 crore. So there is a net impact of 16 crore in that. Apart from that, a regular incremental annual increment cost of salary is around 4 crore. That is why if you compare with the Q4 21 and Q1 FY22, you will see a difference of 20 crore. So we at UGI, we are fully aware of the employee cost, and we are taking all steps to be within the cost which we have incurred in FY 2021. Of overall cost of the group was around 380 crore.
Viraj, just to give the guidance on the saving on the employee cost on account of retirement, as indicated in our earlier call as well, the saving of 65 to 70 crore over a period of next 3 years, it's not a back-ended thing or a front-ended thing, but neither it's a linear progression over the next 3 years. Definitely, a significant portion of this amount will be booked in this and the next year as well. So all we can say is not it's a linear progression only and not a back-ended one at all.
So Viraj, whatever the indication which we have given about the saving, it is in the same line, indication in the same line. So far as ESOP is concerned, a scheme was required to be ratified by shareholders post-listing. So therefore, the shareholders have approved the ESOP scheme. And there only one change, and the change is that the exercise period we have changed from three years to 5 years. That is the only change there. We have issued the new ESOP grant, which we have planned to issue, we have already issued rather, is at the market price. And therefore, I am not expecting any further cost to the P&L other than the defined, ESOP cost. So there will not be any substantial ESOP cost. Or the change, or the policy approval will not have any impact, any additional impact. Let me put this way.
Okay, just a related question,
I'll request you to come back in the question queue. Thank you. I request to all the participants, please restrict to 2 questions per participant. If time permits, please come back in the question queue for a follow-up question. The next question is from the line of Shubhranshu Mishra from Systematics. Please go in.
Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. Hope all of you are doing fine. A couple of questions, sir. First is, what is the sourcing of our equity AUM from PNB, BOB, and SBI? That's the first. Second is, what is our MFO pipeline for the rest of the year? And if you can split it asset class-wise, as in equity and any other schemes. Third is on the ESG, sir. Although you have given the number of women employees in the workforce, I want to specifically know how many women employees in senior management. These are my 3 questions.
Sandeep, can you take the question? Sandeep?
Yes. Yeah, I'm just answering. Subhranshu, thank you for the questions. In PNB as well as BOB, we have a good share of market in gross sales as well as in the SIP. However, as we had mentioned earlier, that SBI is a work in progress. We are continuing to talk with them and to ensure that our funds are included in their selling list. So that is where we are with SBI, PNB, and BOB. In terms of senior management, the women who are there in senior management, I have to count the number, but at least there are 4 or 5 senior officials across we have Swati Kulkarni, who is the senior fund manager in the equity side. We have Bhavna Tiwari, who is in HR who's on the senior position. Then in international business, we have a few women heading our London branch.
Sandring.
So we have a number of people in senior management who are women. And as you know, that we have two directors who are on the AMC board who are women. We have a lady director on the trustee board. As well as in all our active subsidiaries, we have at least one woman director.
Right. And if you could specify how much are we sourcing from PNB and BOB, and what is your NFO pipeline?
No, I don't think so, Branchu, at an individual relationship level, we'll be able to disclose any number.
Right. And in the pipeline, we have an approval which is there for our focused equity fund, which we'll be launching shortly. We have got a SEBI approval for that. And we also have a SEBI approval for a multi-cap fund. So these are two approvals that we have received from SEBI.
Sure. Thank you so much. I'll come back in with you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Madhukar Ladda from Elara Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for the opportunity. A couple of questions. First, sir, I was expecting a slightly higher reduction in employee expenses. So while you quantified the deviation, but shouldn't the number of employees also have reduced from, quarter over quarter and even year over year, and there should have been some savings on that count also? Can you help me with the number of employees and maybe any explanation on that? Second, our other expenses have seemed to have risen both on a year-over-year basis and on a quarter-over-quarter basis. So is there some element as a result of, the higher pension, the fees that you're that we are now allowed to collect due to the PFRDA changed regulations. Is there any expense also related to that which is sort of increased? Just wanted to check on that. And third, our other income has improved substantially. So maybe you could help explain that a little bit. And finally, if you could, give me the closing AUMs in each category, that would be my final question. Thank you.
Yeah, so Madhukar, as of 30th June, we have a total of 1457 employees, out of which 1413 are UTA AMC employees and 14 work with the subsidiaries.
Okay.
Madhukar, in respect of the retirement which you are telling, I think I spoke in the last call also, the total fees which we receive from PFRDA now it will be 5 bits. So what you see as an income of retirement in the presentation which we have already shared, that is the 5 bits. And 1.5 bits is the PFRDA fees which we have to pay, that comes in the administration expenses. So,
if you that is what is causing the increase in expenses.
Yeah, exactly. So, basically, 21.80 crore is the sale of service, and the 6.5 is the administration expenses, which includes 6.23, which is paid to the PFRDA.
And what was the number last year?
Last year, it was PFRDA fees was 1.5 crore. And the total amount was 4.5 crores, right?
Okay, understood.
And Madhukar, on the employee cost, you need to see in the first quarter what happens. There are various employees benefits are there, and therefore based on the actual valuation, whatever amount comes, this need to be charged in the quarter one itself. But from the quarter two and quarter three onwards is not charged. There is another expenses which will come there. But employee cost is an area where we have got a key focus. We are working on this, and this has got my personal attention. And Vinay has pointed out to you that we are also developing a bench of the bright people, so that when the retirement happens, we should not be left with less resources. So therefore, we are creating the bench of the people. Last year we had large number of people. Year before, we had larger number of folks from the campus to mitigate the risk of loss of human resources. But it has got our personal attention, and we are seeing the savings. We are witnessing the savings.
In terms of closing AUM, our closing AUM as on 30th June 2021 was 1,93,940 crores, 35% increase vis-à-vis 30th June 2020 number. A breakup of that, equity AUM is 58,050 crores, hybrid 24,696 crores. So total equity and hybrid put together is 82,747 crores. ETF and index fund constitute roughly around 47,942 crores. Income fund 20,680 crores, and liquid fund constitute around 42,572 crores.
Got it. Yeah, and the other income part.
Madhukar, the other income, if you see, we have, you must be aware, we have some investments in the venture fund, Ascent Fund 3. So they have exited from one of the investment big baskets for which we have received a profit of around 24 crores. And still they have 1.73% stake in the company, and they have other investments also. And the Ascent Fund 3 will be closing around 36.22. So we expect over the period some more exits and some more other income may flow in.
So, okay, that fund still owns about 1.73% in Big Basket. That's what you said,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. That's it from me. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Madhukar.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kapil Agrawal from Itus Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Can you speak a little louder?
Yes. Hi. So I wanted to understand, as your revenue as a percentage of your AUM has increased, what is the reason behind this during this particular quarter?
Hi. So revenue as a percentage to yield is roughly around 44 basis points. Slightly higher as compared to last June quarter number, because as you are aware, last June quarter there was a significant drop in the equity and hybrid AUM because of market depreciation, which impacted our overall yield. But if you compare the last quarter, we are almost in the similar range of around 44 to 45 basis points as far as the AMC yield is concerned. So if you compare here, there is an increase because of the yield in the equity, increase in the AUM of equity and hybrid funds.
And going forward, what is the rough split that you suggest?
I think for a full year, from a guidance perspective, I think the revenue yield from the AMCP should be in the range of around 43 to 44 basis points only.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Aditya Jain from Citigroup. Please go ahead.
Hi, just to confirm on the NPS, the cost, the sharing with PFRDA is 6.23 crores, is what you mentioned. If I see total other expense at a consol level, it is 6.6 crores. Cancel that. So the 6.23 crore is the sharing with PFRDA. Is there also some impact which comes in the staff cost because of the new contract with PFRDA, or is it predominantly another expense?
See, there will be some impact, not a major impact, but not a material impact, but there will be some impact because PFRDA has norms. Different strict norms that the retirement as an institution, as an entity, should have its own compliance officer, own dealer, own fund manager, and own risk management. So based on that, we have already put in place the personnel in different positions. So there will be a cost for that, but it will not be material.
Got it. Thank you. On the tax rate, I think it's at about 18% at a consolidated level. So could you just explain, you know, what all is driving this? I understand the international locations are taxed differently. So going forward, what is the right tax rate that we should take?
Yeah, you're absolutely correct. I think for another 2 to 3 years, we will be having an effective tax rate of 18% to 19% on a group level.
Got it. Thank you. Those are my questions.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kunal Thanvi from Banyan Tree Advisors. Please.
Hi, thanks for the opportunity and congratulations on a recent set of numbers. And I hope everybody at UK is safe and well. And my first question was on, you know, the digital side of the business. Like we had, you know, in the presentation talked about that in terms of the new, you know, customers, 30% was from, you know, digital channels. So I wanted to, you know, understand more about, you know, what kind of tools, what kind of, you know, strategy we are, you know, we have implemented in the digital side of the business in order to, you know, get the integration with the third party aggregators who are gaining market share. And within, like, and also within UTI, like, what are the, you know, new tools that we have, you know, implemented in terms of data analytics and, you know, cross-selling the existing products? That we, like, if you can explain, you know, in a bit detail, it would be really helpful. Thanks.
Sandeep, are you taking this question?
Yes, sir. So, thank you, Kunal. Kunal, we have focused, as Mr. Rehman also said in his opening remarks, we are focusing on the digital growth of the business, and we are refreshing our digital apps as, you know, these digital assets tend to get old very quickly. We are looking to refresh our both our app as well as our website to make it more friendlier to the investor and for easing their transaction journey. We have also started a number of new initiatives. Some of them I can share. Some of them are work in progress and may not be able to share in this call. Maybe in the next call we can share those. But we have started WhatsApp for our distributors. We have started live chatbots and live interaction with our investors and distributors through our website as well as our apps. All these are to help in the assisted journey that the investor takes, and sometimes, you know, there are certain steps where the investor wants to know something more and do some help is required. That is where these live chats come in to help. So, backed by our call center, backed by our data analysis, able to help the investors. We are seeing increasing traction, and as from the presentation, you can see that you know, the number of digital transactions have been increasing. And this quarter, we have witnessed about 17 lakh transactions. So, all the digital effort that we are taking are helping us to get you know, more investors in the digital mode. Of course, we continue to partner with our distributors, providing them apps like our Buddy app as well as our website, which is enabled for the distributor distribution partners to help their investors come through those apps. Kunal?
Sure.
And Kunal, if I can add one point, we are the only AMC in the country, and I don't know about the other organizations, that we have a board level digital transformation committee, and we, this committee is helping us and guiding us to take our digital initiatives forward. We have built a very good team and will continue to invest in the team and in the asset.
Sure. Just a follow-up on that, when you say you've got a digital transformation committee, can you also throw some light on, you know, how do we leverage the digital aggregators in the country? Like how those, since they are, you know, very aggressive in terms of acquiring new customers, how does that journey of acquiring customers from that, you know, aggregator to making the customer a UTI, you know, mutual fund customer, you know, plays out?
Yes, so Kunal, generally most of the aggregators, as you would know, are registered investment advisors. They are not distributors per se who are, you know, selling the advice and rather than distributing the product. So we are partnering with most of the RIAs or fintechs who have come into, you know, come into the business. The most recent one has been PhonePe, where we have successfully integrated our APIs with them. And now all our schemes are live on them. As you would know that there are various fintechs which are doing very well, like Grow, Paytm Money, ET Money, etc. Kuvera. So all these are where we are marketing our products through, you know, rather than we are highlighting our fund managers, highlighting our schemes to these investors so that the good performance of our schemes as well as the, you know, the fund managers are exposed on this channels or on this fintech platform.
Kunal, we are developing APIs to basically on to get connected with them, and we work very closely with all those fintech companies.
Sure, that is really helpful. Just last, if I can squeeze on, was on the UTI retirement business. Can you, you know, throw some light on, you know, how should one look at that business, UTI International, sorry, like in terms of, you know, profitability, how should one look at it from, say, 3 to 5 years perspective?
It's an extremely profitable business. We have, our IDF fund has already crossed, as well, the disclosed number is around $800 million. We are distributing very aggressively our fund. We also have a plan to launch 3 funds, which we will let you know the details in the next quarter. And that is the main focus area for us. So for me as a CEO, I have to grow the both international business and the domestic business and build very strongly the retirement business further for the private sector employees and the AIF business. So I'm giving you the whole full picture of UTI.
Sure, that's really helpful. But what I wanted to understand was from the profitability, you know, in the terms of the contribution to the overall profits, like how should one look at it? What could be the, you know, say 3 to 5 year time? What is something that we should expect?
Today is one of the, if the AUM is like, you know, one of the AMCs, one of the bigger AMCs of the country, right? So going forward, as I mentioned to you, I will not be in a position to give you any forward-looking number, but sure, this company is going to be highly profitable.
Sure, that is helpful. Thank you so much, Ali.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Susmit Patoria from Motilal Oswal Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening everyone, and congratulations. I have 3 quick questions. First is, any progress on the case that is between association?
Your voice is not audible.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, any update on the case between Officers Association and UTI?
Which case are you talking about?
The 500 crore case.
500 crore, there is no 500 crore case. What is that? Is it regarding the pension one?
Yeah.
Are you talking about the pension one?
Yes, sir. The old case pertaining to the earlier UTI.
As you know, the matter is sub judice, and therefore it is not appropriate for me to speak on that. The details which we have given in the DRHP and the RHP is a complete document to follow and read, and the status quo is maintained there so far.
Yeah, so, okay. So there's not been any new dates or anything, correct? That's what I was asking.
No.
Yeah. Yeah. And the second thing, sir, is, you know, while we have increased the dividend payout by about 5-6 percentage points in FY21 over FY20, why isn't the board or the management thinking of a more aggressive policy? Because majority of the free cash is being kept in liquid and income funds, where the post-tax yield is very, very minuscule. So any thoughts on that?
First of
all, I didn't get your name. I missed out while introducing.
My name is Susmit Patodia from Motilal Oswal Asset Management Company.
Patodia, first of all, you should be very happy that we increased the dividend from rupees 7 to rupees 17, 250%. And our we are a very different policy that minimum of the 50% of the profit will be declared as a dividend. And this year we are given over 61%. Right. I understand we don't need much cash to run our business. We are a profitable business we have. But we also need to retain some cash because we are the only professionally managed company in the country, promoterless. And as we go along, we will see based on the cash flow requirement of the company, and the board will review the policy and do the appropriate thing. But our dividend policy is generally in line with the other peers in the industry.
Right. And the last question, sir, is the IPO will complete its 1 year in 2 months. Any discussions that some of the large shareholders are having with respect to their intent now that the 1 year lock-in will be over in a couple of months?
Not to the best of my knowledge and belief.
Okay. Sure, sir. Thank you very, very much, and all the best for the next.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Gaurav Jani from Centrum Broking Limited. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question, sir. Just one question, sir. If you could just elaborate on the UPI retirement solution business, as to how do we look at the flows and how do we look at the asset mix out there? I mean, does it ape the asset mix that we have on the UTI NF book? Thanks.
We didn't get the question. Vinay, could you get the question on the asset mix part? I could not. Or Surajit on the retirement.
Yeah. So basically, what you're talking about, Gaurav, is the type of schemes which are there. So there are different schemes, and an investor has an option to choose the scheme in which he wants to invest. Basically, there are three categories. One is the equity portion, second is the corporate debt, and third is the government security. So an investor makes a choice of the mix that he wants to have. There are certain caps, and there is also an automatic choice where, the allotment keeps on changing as your age increases. So that is basically what you're looking at, what you're mentioning. Secondly, on the flows which you're talking about, of course, the government flows, the flows which come from the government and the private sector are much higher as compared to private sector. But we, as the CEO also mentioned, that it has its personal attention, and we are looking to get more and more clients on the private sector, especially institutions which, for their employees can tie up with UPI retirement solutions for the pension needs. So there, that money will come into the NPS directly.
So could you quantify the flows that we could sort of predict? That is sort of sustainable in the retirement solution business?
Gaurav, we won't be able to quantify the flow, but there is a method by which this flow gets allocated. It is based on the last year's return. Based on that, it gets allocated. Like somebody's return is 10 and somebody's return is 11 and 12. Then suppose a UTI's return is 12, then it will be 12 by 33 into the corpus they want to distribute. The flow gets distributed based on the return of the last year.
Sure. And Sandeep, so you just mentioned on the three main segments, if you could just quantify the mix there, how much is equity, how much is G-Sec, and the remaining debt also, whatever.
You want the assets which are under management in each of these categories?
Yes, or at least the percentage mix.
I'll have to get that. I don't have it offhand, Gaurav.
Sure, sure.
Offline, I will give it to you.
Sure, sure. No worries. Thank you. That's it.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prayesh Jain from Yes Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. A couple of questions. Firstly, on the UPI international business, if I look at the P&L statement, there is a big element of mark to market. Could you explain what is that and it's a significant portion of the other income. So what is that pertaining to until gain on investment?
Yeah, Prayesh, I think you must be knowing last year also the UTI had UTI International seed investment in one of the equity schemes, that is India Dynamic Equity Fund. And that fund over the years have been doing very well, and they had invested in the year 15-16. So according to the market energy, they have a mark-to-market gain, which was last June 20, it was around 37 crore, and this year it's around 21 crore.
Okay. Could you tell the quantum of the investment?
Come back again, please.
Could you tell me the quantum of the investment?
Yeah, the initial investment was around $25 million. And that NAV went up to $41 million, and then they last year, if you remember, around March, they have redeemed around $8 million. So now it's still around $34 million is outstanding as on today. Mark to market value.
Okay. And just a question on my employee cost again. Sorry to harp on that point a bit so much. So on a run rate basis, it will be a good number to assume that for the next three quarters, the total amount that you have reported minus the variable pay would be a good number to assume?
Yeah, we as of now, we are very confident that we will be able to maintain this run rate.
So that is the right number, the total amount minus the variable pay that you have done in this quarter.
Yes. Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much. And all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Pritesh Cheda from Lucky Investment Managers. Please go ahead.
Yeah, sir, just follow up on that question. So if you could just comment the absolute employee cost for the year, what it should be after accounting for whatever retirements plus salary increases and variable costs. It would be good if you could give for the full year. The full year last year was 380 crores.
Yes, well, that is what I think I answered in the one of the first questions which was there. All our efforts, and we have full vigilant on this employee cost, and we will try our best to maintain our employee cost.
Okay. Now, this factors all, right? The retirement and the increase, the salary hikes.
Yes. We have factored already.
Okay. My other question is, any change in the holding at the trustee level?
No further change. Last year, the T-bill price, the holding went up to the 51.5%. After, there is no change.
So, there is no change between last year and as on date?
That's correct.
Okay. And my last question is on the other expense side. So, the other expenses which we see at about 55 crores, is there any variable element in this 55 crores?
There is no variable element as such, but one item I would like to mention, since you are asking this question, the PMS which handles this rural post office linked insurance plan, and the PLI, that is post office linked insurance plan. There is an investment board in Delhi who directs us how much, what should be your equity percentage and what should be your debt percentage. Accordingly, they have taken a call in the first quarter that the equity exposure should be reduced from 18% to 13%. Because of that, there was a brokerage cost of around 6.88 crores, which will not be a recurring in nature, which has come in the first quarter.
So then about 48, 49 crore or 50 crore is a more realistic number which we should take incrementally.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Shubhranshu Mishra from Systematics Group. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity again. What is the market share in our equity and hybrid flow? We have given the number. But what is the market share? That's the first question, sir. And second is, sir, what is the total tech cost per annum and what's going to be the run rate going forward? Two questions. Thank you.
for quarterly market share for equity and hybrid fund put together for June quarter was 5.33%.
No, no, sir. That is on the stock. I'm talking about the flow, sir. You've given the flow as well. On the flow, what is the market share?
On the flow, it should be roughly in the range of around 4%.
4%, sir.
On the net flows that I'm thinking.
Yes. That is equity and hybrid. It should be around 4%.
Yes.
Correct. And what is the tech cost that we are going to incur in FY22, and what should be the run rate that we should model in?
You are asking tax cost?
Technology cost.
Tech cost.
Okay.
Yeah, tech cost, what we factor is around on a run rate basis, for the running cost, it will be around 18 crore, which has been the factor. And obviously another 10 crore we have a budget on respect of the capex.
Okay, so that is only for FY22. So your usual run rate is 18 crores, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Aman Rakesh Shah from GTA Investments. Please go ahead.
Hey, hi. My questions have been answered. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Viraj from Securities Investment Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the follow-up. Hello.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I just had two questions. First is on the international business. Just trying to understand, on the profitability front, if you look at last 1 year, we have seen almost doubling of our AUM. And despite that, our overall profit, we are almost close to break even at the operating level. So just trying to understand, how should one look at profitability, and is it subject to further scale in AUM, then only we'll see profitability, or you see any cost which is there in the, in the financials, which is kind of one-off in nature, and hence, the business should also be, profitable instead. So just trying to understand on this. So that's one. And second is on the employee cost, as you said in one of the earlier participants, that, adjusted for increment is what the normal run rate should be. But, if you look at, we have been giving ESOPs for last 2-3 years. So even the increment intensity in coming years should also gradually reduce. Considerably reduce. Is that the right thinking? Thank you.
Yeah, going forward, ESOP will not be given to the all employees. It will be given to the only, select employees. So therefore, other employees will definitely get a yearly increase. So on UTI international profitability, I don't believe there's any one-time expenses here. It's only all the cost of employees and the administrative expenses of the legal fees which we have to incur to continuously launch the schemes. And as I mentioned earlier, this company is a profitable company. Solid profitable company, and we are acquiring AUMs, and we will continue to book good profit.
So, because just to follow up on this, because if I look at the operational level, I understand you had a much lower AUM in first half of FY21. But even if I look at Q1 22, despite such a healthy growth in AUM, at the EBITDA level, you are not making any money. So whatever growth and fee income we are seeing, that is kind of more than offset by the jump in expenses. So hence, I'm just trying to understand, what will actually drive the profit, since we're expecting a substantial profit in future, what will drive it? Is it higher scale or better yield?
It is a higher scale.
Okay.
Is a growth in the AUM, higher scale.
Okay. And the expenses which have seen a similar jump, what are the major drivers there?
Yeah, you must be saying that from 15,726 crore, it has gone up to 30,498 crore, and there is a jump on the sale of service and revenue from 12 crore to 26 crore. And basically, the trail fees which is being paid in the international market is around 45 bits. So because of the trail commission which has been paid, which is factored in that admin and other expenses, you see a substantial jump over there.
So basically, when this money stays with us for a longer period, because this money has come in the during the May-June period. So once it stays with us for a longer period, you will see a much better revenue jump in UK International.
And is there a carry element in the performance here? I mean, you know, as performance keeps on improving for at the
No level. Carry. No, there's no carry element there.
Okay, fine. Thank you very much and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I now hand the conference over to Mr. Imtiazur Rahman for closing comments.
Thank you, friends, for your participation to this in this, our call. And I can't thank you enough for asking all relevant questions. I would like to assure you and everybody that we will continue to work hard, and it will be our endeavor to be fully compliant, to do the things which is in the interest of the investors and all the stakeholders. And thank you very much for joining this conference. Thank you. Stay safe and stay careful. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. On behalf of UTI Asset Management Company Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us. You may now disconnect your lines.